Fine. So we will talk about a very important instrument in this chapter, which is called moving coil galvanometer. We'll just first check the construction of it. Magnetic frame will be like this, okay, and then there is a pointer attached with this drum. First draw this entire thing. Okay, see, if this is a see in this construction, what is there? There is a north pole and there is a south pole, okay, and you have wrapped a coil around this cylinder. This cylinder is free to rotate about this axis. So it can just rotate like this. Fine. And this coil is wrapped in such a way that the magnetic field is always perpendicular to the coil. Fine. Now, if I pass some current in this coil, if I pass a current in this coil, will it have any magnetic moment? What is magnetic moment, Kevin?
So that, like, the moment due to the magnetic force.
What is the magnetic moment?
I into
A. I into A. Magnetic moment. Fine. It has a magnetic moment or not?
Yeah.
Right? It has a magnetic moment and it is kept in a magnetic field. So will it have a torque? How much is the torque? Torque is M cross B. Fine? Torque is M cross B. So if I put a current in this coil, this entire drum will rotate. Right? And if this drum rotates, the pointer will move. Getting it? If you pass a small current and if you pass a bigger current, what will be the difference in the rotation? If you pass a small current, till when it will rotate? Or will it stop after some time? It will keep on rotating, right? Because the magnetic moment is always perpendicular to the magnetic field, so it will keep on experiencing torque. It will just keep on rotating. Fine. But then if you pass a larger current, what is the difference between rotation due to a larger current and rotation due to a smaller current?
Rotate quicker.
Angular acceleration will be more. When the current is more, angular acceleration will be more. Fine. So basically, this pointer will swing all the way in both. You cannot calculate the angular acceleration while looking at it and determine how much is the current. Fine. So it becomes difficult to check using this right now, as in how much is the current. Fine. So you have to do something else, right? So what you do here is you put a torsional spring over here. Like this. Have you seen the toys? They will have a spring like this. When you put the key, when you rotate the key, it just wraps around like this. Have you seen this?
Yeah.
Right? So when you leave it, it tries to go back to its original shape, like what every spring does. And when it tries to go here, it rotates. Fine. So this torsional spring will create torque. It will not create force. It tries to open up. Are you getting this point? Okay. So just like a linear spring will have force is equal to k times x, a torsional spring will have torque is equal to k times theta, some spring constant k into theta. Depending on how stiff the spring is, the spring constant k will vary for the torsional spring. Getting it? And more you rotate, more is the resistance, torque. Right? When you put the key in the toy, initially it will be easy, then become more difficult because the angle of rotation increases. Right? So similar kind of spring is attached here. One end of the spring is on the moving cylinder, rotating cylinder, and the other end of the spring is fixed on this galvanometer. This is a galvanometer. The other end is on the structure of galvanometer. Getting it? So when this cylinder rotates, only it takes this point and rotates. Getting it? Or you can put this on cylinder and this on the structure, because this point at the center won't even move actually. Fine. So this point will rotate with the cylinder, and this point is on the structure. So what will happen when this moves? The spring will get, right? And because of that, spring will create a torque. Fine. So this coil, which has a current, that coil is also experiencing a torque, right? Because of which cylinder is experiencing torque. But what torque spring is providing is the resistance against the rotation. Spring will oppose any movement from its natural shape and size. Fine. So this, when it rotates, the spring gets distorted. So spring will try to come back to its original. You're getting it? Now, when this will stop, this pointer will stop when torque on this become equal to torque on the spring. Getting it? Head out? No? Right. So, how much is the torque on this coil if number of turns is n and area is A, current is I? How much is the torque on the coil? Torque on the coil due to magnetic field. How much it is? M cross B is a torque, right? Yeah. M is what? N, I, A. This cross with B, B and the magnetic moment, they are 90 degrees to each other. So this is the torque. Fine? And torque on the spring is what? Spring constant times theta. Fine? So when these two become equal, the cylinder will stop rotating. So theta is equal to n a b by k times I. What is theta? The amount of rotation. Fine. So depending on the current, what is the current, theta will be different for different currents, right? And what is this? This is what? Number of turns in the coil, that is inside the instrument. A is area of the coil, again inside the instrument. B is what? Magnetic field. This magnet is inside the instrument. K is spring, again inside the instrument. So this entire thing, the bracket term is called galvanometer constant, because this thing depends on what galvanometer you are using. Everything is inside. Fine. So now if you know the galvanometer constant and you know how much this thing has rotated, you will exactly know what is the current. Getting it?
Yeah.
Right? So you need a torsional spring to stop it so that you will be able to estimate what is the current. Do you know this galvanometer is a very very sensitive instrument? Have you seen this galvanometer in your lab? What you have used it for? Which experiment? Where have you used
cell
and how you calculate internal potentiometer, right?
Yeah, potentiometer.
So you find the null point.
Yeah. Okay.
Have you ever measured the current using galvanometer? You measured it, or you just detected it?
We didn't measure current.
You just detected the current using galvanometer. So galvanometer is a very very sensitive instrument that is used to detect whether there is a current or not. Right? The bigger current, you'll not have. If the current is high, you'll not be like confused about it. But if current is very less, you will try to find out exactly where it is zero. So like in potentiometer where you have to find the null point, right? It is used. And there are other instruments also where the null point is important, where you use galvanometer. Okay? But then if you want to use galvanometer as emitter, you want to actually measure the current using galvanometer. Okay? What will happen in galvanometer, there will be reading of current, there will be a scale in galvanometer also. But the scale will be very very less, like from 0 to 10 milliampere. Fine. But then suppose you want to increase the scale, you want to measure up to 2 ampere. Fine. The galvanometer shows the full deflection for just 10 milliampere. This is 10 milliampere. Fine. So if you pass a current more than 10 milliampere, what will happen? There is a stopper here. It won't go beyond that. So basically what is happening? You are not able to measure beyond 10 milliampere because the scale itself stops at 10 milliampere. Fine? And suppose you want to measure 2 ampere, then what should happen? No, you are free to modify it. No, you can't open up the galvanometer.
It converts to diameter.
How? Tell me the reason. Don't just remember the stuff and how, I mean, what all things are required. If 10 milliampere, beyond 10 milliampere, you're not able to measure. You want to measure 2 ampere. So, what is the thing which you require? You're not understanding what I'm trying to say. What I'm asking you is, suppose you want to measure 2 milliampere, fine? If you pass 1.5 milliampere, what should happen? Should it show full deflection? It should be in between somewhere, isn't it? So, current less than 2 ampere should be less than full deflection. That is required, right? 2 ampere can show the full deflection. So full deflection means 2 ampere then. Are you getting it? So you want to do that. One thing is, as he said, increase the scale length. So how much you'll increase it? You'll make it full circle also, then it also will not become 2 ampere.
Okay.
Are you getting it? Or you
increase it.
See, this doesn't matter. You're not understanding the thing here. This you can shrink it to 2 km also. But the angle of rotation will be determined by what is the current. Fine? It will still rotate. If you show that, okay, this is 2 km now and this is 0 km, it will still show 2 km for 10 milliampere. Are you getting it? So just changing the scale will not help you. Fine? So we have to do something else. Okay? But one thing is pretty sure, that if 10 milliampere current goes inside the galvanometer, it will show full deflection. Fine. So you have to do a construction in which the 2 ampere might be coming from outside, but you just allow 10 milliampere inside the galvanometer, rest of it should be bypassed. Are you getting my point? Fine. So basically externally you are seeing that 2 milliampere is coming, but your circuit should be such that if 2 ampere comes, 10 milliampere goes to galvanometer. If 1.5 ampere comes, only less than 10 milliampere go to the galvanometer. Getting it? So for converting galvanometer into emitter of 2 ampere, it should show full deflection for 2 ampere. Right. So you connect a small resistance in parallel. A galvanometer is shown like this. This is a galvanometer with its own resistance. Let's call it as RG. This is the complete galvanometer. Okay? Draw this.
This has an internal resistance of RG.
Everything has a resistance. So this is like, yeah, internal resistance. Suppose you want to measure a current I, okay? Galvanometer shows full deflection for IG only. Getting it? So what should be the value of small r for galvanometer to measure up to current capital I? Find out.